Every day brings choices to be made, and today is no different. Because today, we have the choice between going with Hannibal Barca, the man who in 218 BC crossed the Alps with African elephants and terrorized the Romans for the next decade. Or we could go with Hannibal Lecter, a man who eats people's faces, and yet everybody still loves him. Let's go with the face eating. Welcome to Travis Book Reviews, where I review books based on how enjoyable they are, read nothing else. Today we've got Hannibal by Thomas Harris. Now this book is a sequel to The Silence of the Lambs, which was a sequel to Red Dragon. Very famous books, but this is the first one written after the astonishing movie Silence of the Lambs was made, and Anthony Hopkins took the character of Hannibal Lecter from, yeah, that's kind of creepy, to, oh my God. Now, a fun little tidbit before we get started is I bought this book at an estate sale with several other books, like 7 or 8 books, and I got it home, put it on my shelf, and you know, that's that. But like a week later, I'm looking at the books on my shelf, and I noticed that there was a bulge in this book, something sticking out of it. I said, okay, wonder what's in there. You know, there's always interesting stuff sometimes in used books. So it had a piece of notebook paper and a wad of money. I pulled out the wad of money and it was just $5 bills. And I was like, oh yeah. And there was a bunch of ones in there. So $35. And I paid like $6 for all the books. So it pays to read, kids. Let's get started on the review. So the premise of Hannibal is that Hannibal is free. Now, if you don't know who Hannibal is, he's a face-eating serial killer. Go watch the movies. Oh my God, go watch the movies. They're so good. Books are pretty good too. The movies will get you up to speed faster. So Hannibal's free, he's living out in Florence, you know, being all sophisticated and whatnot, and Clarice Starling, oh little Clarice, she's working for the FBI, but she's got a dead-end career going on because she won't sleep with who she's supposed to sleep with. I mean, what, you gotta know you gotta sleep with people. What's, do you not watch the news? So anyway, shit hits the fan for Clarice, and Hannibal has got him an enemy, one of his only victims to survive. A guy named Mason, who peeled his own face off while on like some poppers that were called, I don't know, they're like LSD, some kind of. He peeled his face off and fed it to his dogs, and then he ate his own nose. That's cool. So Mason's really rich, really pissed off about this, and wants revenge. Cool. Mason's also a child molester. He deserved it. So anyways, Mason wants to take down Hannibal, and you know, you get this a battle royale of serial killers and child molesters and poor Clarice Starling caught in the middle of it. And there was also a subplot going on between Mason and his sister, which was cut from the movie. The movie's fairly loyal for the most part until the ending, but the subplot with the sister is very intriguing. Very, very intriguing. So for premise, I'm gonna give it 5 stars. So writing, for the most part, it was excellent. It carried the story well. But there were times when there was, I don't know the technical term for this, I'm sure there is one, but it was kind of like a fourth wall break, where it's like, see Clarice Starling, see this room. In this room there are things, in this thing there are, and you know, the kind of really, really detached narrator voice. And it was jarring to me. I didn't care for it, and that's coming from a guy who did it. I did that once in The Dreamer. You know, looking back on it, I wish I hadn't done that. Mostly it was just really inconsistent for me for it to slip into that. So it was jarring. I didn't care for it. It's also written in third person omniscient, which I'm not a huge fan of it, because you don't really see what one character knows and what they don't know. At least when this book, it wasn't the case. When it's done really well, you can. In this one, there would be scenes where I was like, okay, what does Clarice know? Does she know everything that's going on? Does she know about that? Does she know about this? And I just didn't know. It was really, to me, it was a very detached, omniscient voice for the most part anyways. Even apart from when it went into the super detached, like fourth wall breaking kind of detached. So I would have preferred it to be written in third limited, just so I could see what's going on, just so I could feel what their understanding of the mysterious circumstances are. But for the most part, writing's fine, so I'm gonna give it 4 stars. Humor is very little, and that's kind of sad, because Hannibal at least the on-screen Hannibal, such a witty character. But well, there were a few little witticisms. There was a point on a plane where a little kid was like, "Hey, can I eat your food?" And Hannibal wants to be like, "Fuck off," but he's like, "Yeah, sure, no, you wouldn't want it." And like, "My mom won't mind," and then he gets the mom involved, and the mom checks a diaper first, and then starts pawing through Hannibal's food. I mean, it was a funny scene. There weren't many funny scenes, but that was definitely one of them. It was very, very well done. So for humor, I'm gonna give it 4 stars. Characters. It's freaking Hannibal Lecter. I mean, come on. Clarice had some inconsistencies in her character. A huge inconsistency later on, and we'll talk about that at the ending. Mason, he was pretty intriguing. I loved the sister. I loved the dynamic between the sister and Hannibal's old guard or orderly. So the characters really felt genuine, which is kind of horrifying. But characters, I'm gonna give it 5 stars. Journey. How much did I enjoy reading the book? I really enjoyed it. I did. It wasn't one of those where I was like itching myself if I couldn't get to the book, but it was definitely one where I enjoyed picking it up every time that I did. So Journey, I'll give it 5 stars. Ending. Spoilers, whatnot. The ending was absolutely absurd. Now, if you haven't read the book, the ending is quite a bit different from the movie. This is where the real divergence happens. So the end, they got Hannibal, they got him locked up and ready to go. They're gonna feed him to the hogs, and then Clarice saves the day, shoots up places. Mason isn't pushed in with the hogs in this case, but they shoot everybody. Clarice gets hit with some narco darts, which are basically just tranquilizer darts. She gets hit with a couple of them, so she's really out of it, and Hannibal carries her away. Mason's sister, who wanted some sperm from Mason so that she could impregnate her lover, so that her lover could have a kid of their line so that they could inherit the money. She sticks a cattle prod up old Mason's derriere, gets some, you know, prostate stimulation, got what she was after, and she kills everybody. She kills his nurse with a hammer or something like that. It's a hammer, right? I think so. And then she kills Mason by sticking an eel in his face. Okay, so there's that ending. I love that ending. But the ending that really, it was just so absurd, was that Hannibal kept Clarice, and not like in the movie. This time he has her all like doped up and shit on some drugs he stole from a hospital. He has her just like chilled out, the fact that she's with them. And then they eat the guy like they did in the movie. They eat his brains, but she's into it. And you know, he says something rude and she goes, "I want some more!" Like, you know, she quotes Oliver Twist. And then, the very end, they're seen in Buenos Aires, and they're husband and wife living together, and you know, he's not using drugs on her anymore, and they're happy, and it's like, what the? It was such a character break from Clarice Starling. She wouldn't do that. I don't think. I mean, would even Hannibal do that? Would he really want a wife? I don't know. But it was, I thought it was absurd. I much prefer the ending of the movie where, you know, they go their separate ways. Them being lovers, it was just, no. So ending, I'm gonna give it 3 stars. So overall, what do I think of Hannibal? Is it as good as Silence of the Lambs? No. Is it as good as Red Dragon? No. Those two books are astonishing. This one's merely good. It's a good book. And let's be frank about it. Would this series have gotten to be as popular as it is if it wasn't for what Anthony Hopkins did with the character? And I really think the answer to that is no. The movie made the books. And one of those rare exchanges where the movie was just better because, really, solely because of what Anthony Hopkins did with the character. But when you read them now, you're putting Anthony Hopkins in that role. And you're having that charm and the wit of what Anthony Hopkins did. Where in the book, I don't know if that would be the case if I hadn't seen the movies. But overall, I'll give it 4 stars. It's a good read. It's enjoyable. I hope you're not an addict of Thomas Harris, because the dude takes forever to write books. I think each of his books is at least 8 years apart. He might have picked it up more in recent years. But that has been a Travis Book Review. Until next time, Keep reading.
Thank you.